Hello, I'm Ron Bacon. I'm the mayor of East Lansing, but I'm also a commissioner on MLK Commission for Mid-Michigan. And we're just here celebrating the legacy and life of Dr. Martin Luther King with our whole community and the whole region here. We're just really excited. And we have with us today Attorney Fred Gray, the attorney for Martin Luther King and many other elements of the civil rights movement. The reason this is so important is just kind of that we gather together, look around the room, and this can be a starting point for the year where we kind of start to commit ourselves to service, to duty, and to being part of a larger and global community. And that's Dr. King's dream. And I think we all seek to continue that dream here and just be that wonderful place here in mid-Michigan that can be an example for the nation.
We're always constantly striving to be better, but on days like this, we pause to reflect on how far we've come, but also recognize how much farther we have yet to go. So we're here at the 38th annual celebration of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s life and legacy. It's one of the oldest in the country, if not the oldest. Really excited to be here. It's always a sellout crowd. Great message, great speakers, and always just a joy to hear from all our really talented young people as they present their scholarship-winning essays and talk about the importance of this legacy and why we celebrate this man and this day. So I'm really thrilled to be here, and it's an honor to represent the City Council.
Welcome back. I am so excited to see all of you. Glad that we are able to be back in person again. You know, when we left here on, I believe it was January 18th, 2020. We had been on a succession of record years for attendance at this event. And I was looking so forward to our 2021 event to break another record. But then we all had this thing happen, right? We started acknowledging that we were in a global pandemic. And it caused us to have to take a two-year hiatus from being together. And we missed you. We missed having the opportunity to bring our community together around this extraordinary day, honoring the life and legacy of Dr. King. You know, it wasn't all bad that we were gone, 'cause we won an Emmy. Yeah. We won an Emmy for our 2021 broadcast of our interview with Dr. Bernice King. So you can actually see that again, but I'm excited. But it was really nice to win an Emmy, but it doesn't compare to what happens here on the third Monday in January. It doesn't compare to where, if you could see where what I see when I look out there and I see people of all colors, all genders, all faiths, people from all walks of life, and we're here together because we believe in the legacy of Dr. King. We believe in his work. It just blows me away each time. So while we may not be at record attendance, but I want you to kind of take a look around and take it in, a lot of y'all came, and I'm so excited to see all of you. I get the pleasure of introducing our honorary chairperson, Mark McDaniel, but first I've got to say two things. You know, for the last decade or so, the commission has really worked to bring our living national treasures, is what we refer to them, our living civil rights icons, those people that had direct connection to the movement and direct connection to Dr. King. And this year, we got blessed by God. He pulled heaven open and kissed us because we got Fred Gray. So sometimes people hear that name and they're like, who is Fred Gray? And Fred Gray was the premier civil rights attorney. He was the guy that defended this lady called Rosa Parks when she dared to sit down on a bus in Montgomery, Alabama and refused to get up. And they sparked the Montgomery bus boycotts. That bus boycott was the blueprint for our civil rights movement. And we got the guy that was sitting around with them strategizing right here with us. He's not, yeah. He's 92. He still goes into his law practice every day. He's still fighting for our civil rights. I told him he didn't even have to say anything. He could just come stand up here and I'm gonna be happy. But I wanna let you know that it ought to challenge all of us. Cause if he could start it and still work it, then we can finish it. So that was the first thing I wanted to say. And the second thing I wanted to say is thank you. You know, we've been doing this for a long time. This commission was established over four decades ago. And our primary purpose then was to push for federal legislation for a King holiday. But when it happened, this community didn't quit. We didn't stop the work then. We recognized that we had more work to do. And until we live in a country where it really doesn't matter, when it really doesn't matter what color your skin is, when it really doesn't matter who you love or who you worship or where you live, then we gotta keep working. We all have to keep working. And so I am excited to tell you that I know that you're in the fight, because you could be any place else today, but you came here. So we're gonna have a good time. We're gonna have some good music. We're gonna be inspired by Mr. Gray. And we're gonna go out of here before the tip-off for MSU. Go Green. It's really difficult because I used to be able to have x-ray vision and see behind the curtain, so I'm hoping that Mark is standing behind there. You know, this guy really doesn't need any introduction, right? You remember Mark, he's been our honorary chair for I think 6 years now. He is a devoted friend to this commission. He just puts everything in it, right? He's a guy that puts his money where his mouth is, his heart where his mouth is, his body where his mouth is, and he just continues to do the work. He has coined this phrase that you may hear today. He said, "I'm awakened and I ain't shaken." So he don't mind being woke, and he don't mind telling you. And I just want to just bring up our amazing friend and honorary chairman, Mr. Mark McDaniel.
I'm so sorry. Thanks. Well, hello, everyone. Sure is nice to see humans. First of all, I have to apologize. I have to apologize to the commission that I came late. It's embarrassing. I'm sorry, kind of threw things off. I'm also the same guy that forgot to bring our marriage license when we got married. So we are not married for our week of our honeymoon, and we had to have the pastor come back to our house and actually do it in our living room with our landlord. So that's what you got with me. I have three things I want to do. First of all these years I've been doing this, we have never, ever recognized the amazing work that our sign language people do here. When the music gets going, they don't just stand and do it. They dance with the music. I love watching it. The second thing is, this is the first time we've been here as a group since the passing of James Butler III. And I really like to take a moment of silence for him. He is a very important person to me, but I think that we should do the right thing and recognize him today while we're out here. So bow your heads and just a moment of silence. Thank you. My third thing, this is one of the things I love doing. I learned this from Reverend Ann Johnson, who I worked with in Detroit. She ran she was a pastor of a church, but she ran a shelter. This is back in the late 80s, early 90s, before I was even doing this. She became godmother of our youngest son. She's a very, very important, close person. I learned a lot from her. So this is what I call my Al Green love and happiness moment. I'd like to have everybody stand up. And I would ask all of you, I know this is the COVID thing, I don't know if you want a hug or whatever, but I want you to turn to everybody around you, tell them that you love them, show them a sign of peace. All right, thank you. Thank you, everyone. So, now, I'm really happy to be here and not have to go by a script. The last 2 years, even though we won Emmys, or won one, we're up for another one, it was really one of the more difficult things I've ever had to do is do a TV show with a script. I'm really happy. I told at the press conference, I got 2 years worth of stuff in my head that I haven't been able to say for 2 years because everybody's telling me what I can say and what I can't. So today, you might wish I had a script, but I gotta let it all out. First of all, Sener, we've been a proud sponsor of this event for a long time. We believe in everything the commission is about. We are committed to what the commission's work is. It's personal for me, what we do. Our organization, this is our 30-year anniversary. Thank you. 30 years ago, I walked into a little house on Lenaway Street to start this thing called the Michigan Capital Fund for Housing, which it hadn't really ever been done before. And I walked in, they told me it was going to be furnished. There wasn't a piece of furniture in it. So I said, how do I run a business without furniture and a phone? So I ran home, grabbed our card table. It was actually my grandfather's card table, our phone and our answering machine, and that was my first day of business. And I was charged with raising $10 million, which they told me would take 10 years. Three years. We did it in 14 months, and that was our start. Our why of who we are and why we do what we do is we believe all people deserve the opportunities that are provided by living in a healthy community. That's why we're here. That was the vision I had that we were charged when we started to raise money and put that money into communities that had no access to capital. And for my banking friends, my insurance company friends, at that time, you saw way too much risk in those neighborhoods. And that was what I was charged to do, was go where nobody else would go. We've done that. We're in 9 states. We have raised and are managing over $7 billion, $7 billion of investment and lending in communities that nobody wanted to be in. I love this work. And to look out over all of you today, you're the reason that I do this, and our wonderful staff. I wouldn't be anything if not for our staff, the people I've been able to surround myself with. So, 30 years, and here I am today. The next thing is, the last few years, I think a lot of people got complacent, thinking that all the things that people fought so hard for had kind of gone away. They'd all got put in a box. Well, the lid on that box got ripped off over the last few years, horribly. all that hate and prejudice and everything just came flying out of it, and we have not been able to pack it back in. Again, this is why the commission's work is so important. This is why we're so committed to the commission. There's this term that has now come out about being woke. And it has, in a way, been weaponized as a term that shows weakness. It shows that you're not with the mainstream, that you're going to take the country down a path that is a terrible path. I said this last night, but what do we do when we wake up in the morning? We wake up, right? We're awake. What is it when you don't wake up in the morning? You're dead. So I like to be awake, okay? Being awake is woke. So being awake is that's how we get this work done. Being awake is that you listen, that you're curious, that you ask questions, you have uncomfortable conversations, and you pause. You pause and you listen. You become aware of who you're with and the being of the person that you are with. That is what being woke is. Okay? Watching what happened on January 6th, and if you read Proverbs, there's a whole statement in there about what fools are. Well, according to Proverbs, there are a lot of fools, by definition, running around with Confederate flags and all the things that, you know, we all thought been buried. Well, I tell you, man, their brains are dead. Their hearts are dead. I like being awake. I like being woke because my brain is working. My heart is working. And I've been challenged on this a few times. And the thing is, this is what Elaine was mentioning, is I, you know, for me, when people have come at me, I said, you know what? I ain't quaking because I'm awakened. That's it, man. I am not quaking because I am awakened. And that's something we all need to think about as we go out of here today. We hear the music, the inspiration, in the words that we're going to hear in the celebration of Dr. King's legacy. I have one more thing. This is where it may be a little uncomfortable for some, but that's what this is. We're supposed to do, right, Elaine? This was in 1979. There was an interview that ABC did on 2020. This is the beginning days of 2020, 1979. They interviewed James Baldwin. It was supposed to be a big deal. Big interview of James Baldwin. Big score for the producer, Joseph Lovett. Show never got shown. Because what he talked about in that interview is what we now call today white fragility. It just has come out that this show was never shown. And the execs at ABC, the reason they told Lovett that it wasn't shown is because no one wants to hear a black gay has-been talk. That's 1979. So I want to read you some of the word, the transcription from some of that interview that struck me, and to think about today and back then. That interview, it started with, he said, white people go around, it seems to me, with a very carefully suppressed terror of black people. A tremendous uneasiness, Baldwin said. They don't know who, they don't know what the black faces hide. There sure is hiding something. What's it hiding is American history. What it's hiding is what white people know they have done and are doing. White people know very well one thing. That's the only thing they have to know. They know this. Everything else they'll say is a lie. They know they would not like to be black here. They know that. They know that, and they're telling me lies. They're telling me and my children nothing but lies. The interviewer then asked Baldwin about Americans' attitudes towards blacks, as he's surrounded by all his nieces and nephews in his mother's apartment. He says, "It's a price this republic exacts on any black man or woman walking, and that is a crime. I have paid for that crime in my life, and I don't believe my countrymen anymore. They will not do to him what they failed to do to me. I was seven, and him was his nephew," he pointed at. "I was 7 years old 47 years ago, and nothing has changed since then. Look, and as he's talking to the interviewer, "I don't mean it to you personally. I don't even know you. I have nothing against you. I don't know you personally. I know you historically. You can't have it both ways. You can't swear to the freedom of all mankind, but put me in chains." The interviewer then states, "It seems that we are all cursed by the history of slavery." His response is, "Well, it is a curse. The American sense of reality is dictated by what Americans are trying to avoid. And if you're trying to avoid reality, how can you face it? If you don't know what's going on in the ghettos of this nation, in the hearts and minds of women and men you see every day, in that case, you don't really know what's really going on in your heart and mind, and you know, have no way of knowing what's going on in the hearts and minds of millions of other people on this globe." In ending, the interviewer asked him, "It seems he has a role to tell people what they don't want to hear." And his response is, "Yeah, I have. I've tried. No, I've really tried." And yes, and he just kind of paused, and he said, "Mahalia's song says, wake the children sleeping. I'm supposed to be a disturber of the peace." Think about that. Sounds like John Lewis. But that's why I ain't quaking, because I'm awakened. Okay? Thank you. Now, I'd like to introduce Elder Alphonse Pitawanakwe, and also Dr. Nicole Bieber of the Waganakaising Odawa Tribal Citizen. I did it. And have them come out and do a land blessing and a Ojibwe blessing.
Hello, everyone. My name is Aaron Dokum. I'm a language consultant for Ojibwe and Anishinaabemowin, and I'd like to introduce Alphonse Pitawanakwe, who's going to do our land acknowledgement and our blessing. And it's a very—we are very proud and honored to be a part of this today, and it's new to us, and I'm very grateful, and so are we. So, thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Alphonse Petwaniquet. I will say the prayer first and translate in Ojibwe and translate it into English and do the land acknowledgement as well and do the same thing. This is a traditional prayer that we use for before any ceremonies in our life. Gshem Nedo, which means creator. Gshem Nedo kin de benjgein, gdo gitnama wose ma wosen mi wenge, jeshwen mi yang, we weke bis yang, eshen duen demang mokunigewe. Creator, you, the owner of the universe, we are offering tobacco with hope for your blessing to gain our wishes on revelations of history. Migoch kidigo. Nishnam Mishum Sinanik Minonokum Snanik China Wagayajik Nungo Ayajik Mino Wabungayajik. Thank you, grandfathers and grandmothers of yesterday, today and tomorrow. Miguch Mnidok Ayaik Not Nong Nibing Shkudeng Mino Aking. Thank you, spirits of the winds, water, fire and earth. Miguch Mnidok Aya Giwet Nong Wab Nong Shao Nong Mino Epigishmuk. Thank you, spirits of the north, east, south and west. Miguchusein Yi Gimijang Wimamuyang Jinatamadiyam. Thanks for giving us a chance to get together to work together. Esnawidokushnang Wim Namadziam. Please help us to live a good life. Miigwech kishem nido. Thank you, Creator. Now the land acknowledgement written by Dylan Miner, professor at MSU. I condensed it so we wouldn't take all day to do it. Eshignom Jagadikke, Eshigabwimgak, provisional land acknowledgement. Doma mwe de wendana, Trishkodang is Otnishnavik, Ojibwek Udawak Minapurwadmik, Katang Chigming, Gibidawat, Gibian Kosiat Minamegwa in Etnizot, Memdegagumon Pin Kwejonong. Tem Gokum Ke Kabagitniga Dek 1819 Sagana Wawindamago winning. Nasduin Mananik Wundum Daswis Shanish and Sungudanigis Ot Nishinavik Shindum Michigan Kchigima Nestom Margin Mino Givega Beginnigas Kakunashkagas Jik Takimong. Because then, Mount Wundake, Eshgabuimgak, Mishquenda, Nanishnave, Dibendisit, Gavi Shrevok, Minogavi, Kishkumuat. We collectively acknowledge the Three Fires Confederacy of Ojibwe, Odawa, and Potawatomi peoples that occupied the land around the Great Lakes, in particular the Greater Lansing area, ceded in 1819 Treaty of Saginaw. We recognize Michigan's 12 federally recognized Indian nations and those who were forcibly removed from their homelands. In offering this land acknowledgement, we affirm indigenous sovereignty, history, and experience. Miigwech, Miigwech.
It's not Chimigwech Alphonse, when I go Kim Nichge, Oshichge. Thank you, Alphonse, again, for doing such a great job in representing. I'm going to do a small invocation for the event. Just going to go ahead and get started. So this is an invocation to for Martin Luther King Jr.'s impact on our Native Americans, which can't be overstated. This is a read that I actually took out of powwows.com, its website on Facebook as well. And the article was last updated on January 27th, 2021 by Jared McCarran. But I actually tweaked it up a little bit because this just, it's a personal one. So I kind of want to just share it on behalf of Anishinaabek. So here we go. As we celebrate Martin Luther King Jr. Day, we look back on the indelible mark left behind by the famed civil rights hero, best known for his work on racial equality and ending racial segregation in the United States. So this is how Martin Luther King Jr. helped Native Americans. In the late 1950s, King worked with a Porch Band of Creek Indians tribal leaders working to desegregate their schools in South Alabama. The tribe had reached out to King after learning of King's desegregation campaign in Birmingham, so he willingly helped. At the time, Native American or Native children were allowed to ride in school buses to previously all-white schools, but dark-skinned Native kids from the same band were not allowed to ride the same school buses. With King's assistance, the problem was resolved and Native kids from the same band were allowed to ride the same school buses, marking a major step forward to desegregation. At the 1964 march in Washington, Native Americans showed up in full force. King's civil rights movement had, in part, motivated the Native American rights movement in the 1960s. In fact, the Native Americans Fund was modeled after the NAACP's National Association of Advanced of Colored People, Legal Defense and Education Fund. By 1900, the Native American population in the U.S. had dwindled from tens of millions down to just 237,196 per Census Bureau numbers. According to King, the genocide of the American Indian was national policy. Today, however, the Native American population has grown to 6.9 million people as of 2021, alone in combination with another race, representing nearly 2% of the national population by 2060, the U.S. American Indian Alaska Native population is estimated to reach 10 million, or approximately 2.4% of the U.S. population. And while there's still immeasurable work to be done, King's influence on the Native American rights movement and, of course, on the U.S. and at world large can't be overstated. So again, Chimigwich for the commission have us represent our First Nations and Indigenous people. And thank you as well for honoring our tradition of thanks by offering us tobacco to do our work and representation. Chimigwich, thank you very much.
That was a really cool call. Thank you. All right, now, I'd like to do our national anthem. We have a really great, great artist with us today in Wintley Phipps. He has sung for, I can't even name all the presidents, but in our lifetime. It's just really a pleasure to introduce Wintley to sing our national anthem.
Twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. All the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, stay us that star-spangled banner, yeah.
How's that for a start? Now we will move to our greetings and remarks from our elected officials. First, I'd like to introduce Teresa Woodruff, our interim president at Michigan State University, of which I'm a proud alumni of. Go Green! There we go. So with that, Teresa Woodruff.
Thank you, Mark. I heard the go green and started running. So I'm glad to be here with all of you. Elaine, Mark, everyone, hello, thank you. It's really an honor to be here in this room with all of you as together we celebrate the legacy and the words of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And I really want to thank the MLK Commission. Thank you so much for all you've doing to help us all engage in this way. And I also just want to thank and welcome all of the partners across the state of Michigan, the local region who are here. And so let me just begin my few remarks today with, I was introduced as the new or the current or the interim. There are a lot of different words, but I wanted to draw out that one of those words from what is the theme for today's luncheon, which when Dr. King said, now is the time to lift our nation from the quicksand of racial injustice to the solid rock of brotherhood. And so the word that I'll bring to you from Michigan State University and my greetings from all of us there across that university is the first word of this statement, the word now. Dr. Keem famously spoke on the fierce urgency of now in speeches and sermons and elaborated on that theme when he spoke at Michigan State University in 1965. That idea that King spoke to all of us who metaphorically, or in some cases, some of you in this room were there, came to really talk about freedom, human dignity, and the necessity of each of those words now. The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice, he told them, repeating another of his brilliant themes. But he cautioned that group sitting just about 2 miles from here in the old auditorium theater, he cautioned them with this sentence: time is neutral. And then he said, it can be used either constructively or destructively. Somewhere, he said, we must come to see that human progress never rolls in on the wheels of inevitability. It comes through the tireless efforts and persistent work of dedicated individuals. He concluded with another memorable idea that is as true now as it was then. The time is always right to do right. I too believe there is no time to waste in building inclusive communities and a university that is welcoming to all. There is moral reason that an inclusive community is the right way to live, and through which we create new knowledge as we ask inspiring questions, we solve problems, and we provide that thinking to a new generation of learners. But inclusion and learning is hollow if we hold a basket over our light. I believe that the meaning of a land-grant institution in 2023 is that we have transparency in our walls so that we transmit back to the field everything we learn. And we find the problems of our society and don't shy away from taking those problems on. We shake them up, tackle them, sometimes fail at them, but sometimes we get it right. And then we send it back to the society that so urgently needs the thinking of our students, faculty, and staff at Michigan State University. When we get this equation right, the work, the learning, the research, the problem solving, the solution sets, we make a difference that can be measured, and we collectively matter. Now, this work has been going on for a long time. Little lights here and little lights there. And so what we must now do is light a torch and light a bonfire. We need to take our collective candles and put them together so that we in this room can be seen from lower Earth orbit. We have meditated on that first word of the inscription. Let me ask us now to think on the last. Now is the time to lift our nation from the quicksand of racial injustice to the solid bedrock of brotherhood. As I was preparing my mind for this week of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s birth and life and all of the celebration across Michigan State University and the region, I revisited MSU's alumni chapel. It was designed in 1947 and opened in 1952. There are 38 stained glass windows that tell the MSU story and depict our moral and educational goals. My reason for visiting was to lift up my eyes, gather strength, and think about all of you. I wish I were in the room when those images were unveiled and hear John Hanna's reference to the ways in which diversity of Michigan State was intentionally depicted in those images. That was our post-war years, and MSU at that time eschewed the notion, as we do now, of separation. Diversity was designed into that space, and President Hanna served as the first chairperson of the U.S. Commission on Civil Rights. Michigan State University was leading the nation through this commission. And in the middle and in the front of that chapel is the image of brotherhood. Images of every color of person holding hands with each other, intertwined in a circle, looking outward to defend against tyranny, holding fast to each other. All hands of different colors, brotherhood, held fast by the bond of each other. I imagine Dr. King coming to our campus in 1965, coming to our region to bring us good words on brotherhood. I imagine him standing in that chapel, looking up and thinking about all of us that he would address that day, and seeing that image of brotherhood already embellished within the very hearts and minds of Michigan State University. Our Wharton Center for the Arts was named for the first African-American leader of a university in America, President Cliff and First Lady Dolores Wharton, whom Tom, my husband, and I had the honor of visiting on Saturday in New York City. They send their greetings to all of you, and I said I would bring them happily, and I assured them of our love and gratitude and respect, for they were the first to lead a university of this kind. And this morning, our campus, thank you. And this morning, our campus committee writ large marched from the iconic Beaumont Tower in the heart of North Campus to the site of our new and coming freestanding multicultural center. We celebrate our leaders across campus, and let me just name Dr. Rima Vassar, who was elected as the first Black chairwoman of the Board of Trustees of Michigan State University. So Michigan State University has been part of a proud tradition. We are learning and leaning into the now, and we are happy but not satisfied with what we are done. Dr. King came to our campus in 1965 during a propitious hour, and with leaders such as Hanna and Wharton and Vassar, we will continue to live up to the charge and the urgency of now and the necessity of brotherhood. Let us commit together. Now is the time to lift up our nation from the quicksand of racial injustice to the solid rock of brotherhood. And let us build not just hope, but an expectation of progress in short order. Michigan State University lives this promise. Thank you very much.
Mary and I got married in that chapel. It's a very special place. Next. I'd like to introduce our Honorable Mayor of the City of Lansing, Andy Schor.
This is awesome. It's just great to see so many people here again. Thank you for all being here. Thanks, everyone. Welcome, and thank you for being here today to honor the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Again, I'm happy to be here with you all in person. And don't forget, as you leave here to go watch the state game, go green. There it is. All right, as you leave to watch, let's go watch the state game, feel free to stop at any of our bars here in Lansing, grab a beer, cheer for your team, grab another beer. I'm going to go off script for just a second, and then I'll be quick, I promise, because I know you all, you know, we want to get to the show here. But I was going through the program, and I noticed, and I had forgotten, that the first 5 years, the commission chair was a gentleman named Willard Walker. He is here with us today. Willard, will you stand up? I know you're here. I'm looking around. I know he's here with us today, but Will, there he is, in the back. Willard is back working for the city, and he's doing a great job. He has been for the last few years, but now that I've embarrassed him sufficiently, he's going to get teased by the rest of our folks at the city. It's great to see everybody here. We're joined here today to celebrate the life of a man we lost violently more than a half century ago. As Americans and as communities, we know we have to do all we can to make things better. What an honor to welcome Mr. Fred Gray, a living legend, to celebrate this day and to honor his friend Dr. King right here in Lansing. Welcome, Mr. Gray. I got to meet with him yesterday, and I got a little bit of his speech, his thoughts, and we're in for a show. So thank you for being here. We remember the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. not only for what he did, but for what he dreamed. We've seen so much progress since he was murdered for his beliefs in equality and equity, but for all that our nation has accomplished, and Mark mentioned this, for all that we've accomplished in achieving our goals, social justice and equal opportunity, a lot remains to be done. Not just in expanding civil rights, but also in preventing renewed efforts to roll back Dr. King's achievements. From preserving voting rights to helping those in need, we have to ensure that we all have the same ability to succeed, and we have to continue to do the work as Mr. Gray does at 92 years old. I'm proud of our city of Lansing. We're taking this on directly. We crafted a racial justice and equity report, and we now have an official city diversity, equity, and inclusion board. We're appointing members now. Thank you for all those who applied. We had so many wonderful applicants. And they are getting together to work with our city's chief diversity officer to implement this plan. This year's theme for this event here is, now is the time to lift our nation from the quicksands of racial injustice to the solid rock of brotherhood. This comes directly from Dr. King during his I Have a Dream speech. Like so many of Dr. King's speeches, the theme of lifting up our nation rings true today. The city of Lansing and our region has shown that we can come together to support all of our citizens, and I'm grateful to so many in our community for demonstrating what is great about Lansing, our resilience and our sense of community. So I want to thank the incredible work of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Commission of Mid-Michigan for the work they're doing today and to put together this wonderful program with Mr. Fred Gray. Our commission does an incredible job. I say this everywhere. You have boards that are volunteer just for name, and you have working boards. Our board is a working board. They do so much work, and it's volunteer. Mark is always such a great MC. This is a wonderful program. And I'll ask you to thank one other group. Please don't forget to thank your servers today. We, like all of you, thank you. Like all of you, we have staff shortages. And we did our best to pack this room, and looking at it, it's great. Next year, all this empty space you see, that's all going to be filled too. But coming up with staff was hard, and the folks who are here are going to do a really, really difficult job. So I ask you to be patient, and I ask you to thank them. Also, we got a few staff from my staff who are running around as volunteers. So if they screw up your meal, please, a little bit of grace. We appreciate it. So I want to thank everybody. So I love attending this lunch every year. You have a proclamation in your book where I am proud to proclaim today as Martin Luther King Jr. Day here in the city of Lansing. I thank you all for being here, and enjoy. Have a great day. Thanks.
Now I'd like to introduce the Honorable Mayor of East Lansing, Ron Bacon.
First of all, I too want to thank the servers. And as I was thinking about that, I think we hear a lot of the conjecture around people quiet quitting and doing a lot of things like that. I consider this a quiet labor movement, and I have for a long time. And I'm excited for the individuals who are participating in it and fighting for higher wages. And members up here in Michigan, now that you have the gavels, continue to fight for higher wages as this labor movement continues. First of all, I want to thank the commission, the city of Lansing, for welcoming us. I see some of my fellow council members over there. I always want to thank them for their support and in the missions of what we're trying to do here in the spirit of Dr. King, their allyship and support for that mission. And most importantly, I want to welcome you from the city of East Lansing, where it's always go green. Yeah, I want to also thank all the other dignitaries and individuals here. This is a room full of power, and my motto for East Lansing is everything that we need is already in the room. Every solution, everything we need for this state and for this nation probably resides somewhere in this room. I want to honor and thank our chair, Madam Elaine Hardy, for directing us and keeping us on track with this and bringing this back to life. And when I was in the back, I was thinking, since there's less people, and this is just a big family reunion, there, at lunchtime we will do the hustle over in these two sections over here and use the space wisely, so we won't waste it. And they'll be jealous if they were the other 1,000 people who weren't here today. I'm here, honestly, today to honor Fred Gray. Last night I was a little flooded. I couldn't even pull together the words, because as you read through his bio, it's overwhelming. It's overwhelming. Dr. Denise Maybank spoke of Fred Gray and called him an icon. To me, as I couldn't sleep last night, I didn't find that sufficient. I'll say first, Fred Gray is a patriot, a man of great honor. But it gets better than that. It gets better than that. I would argue that Fred Gray is a founding father of this nation. Someone's going, whoa. Oh, no. Fred Gray demanded that this nation live out its founding principles. Until the nation lives out its founding principles, I'd argue it hadn't even started yet, until a man like Fred Gray stepped up and took on the nation. I get a little embarrassed. I was thinking about some times when I was afraid to make tough decisions or tough calls. And then I picture now Fred Gray sitting across the table talking about the principles and the laws of these great states of the United States of America versus the United States of America. So for me, the audacity of when I feel fear or any consternation on making a tough call or a tough decision now is washed away. Because I couldn't imagine that type of opposition. We talk D's and R's and independents and all the opposition and even the members of the insurrection. Is that really opposition versus you stand against the greatest nation in the world and demand that they live up to their creed? That's something. That is a founding father. Fred Gray's legacy is secure. His autobiography is already written. And as I look at the notes in his history, I'd hope to be a period or a comma somewhere in that autobiography. I say I stand on the shoulders of giants and all the people who've come through Lansing to make me and allow me to stand and sit in this position or allow this room to be present. And as I said last night, allow many of our families to be legal, our marriages to be legal, our worship to be legal. Think about it. And today, us even being here is simply a byproduct of his sacrifice. And I'm here to honor him, appreciate him. I will sit and bask in this. And then the coach inside of me will say, be where your feet are. Be present here today and understand who's here. Be where your feet are and steady yourself for battle, because if he's here and we were blessed to have him in our presence, then it means the battle's coming. So steady yourself, glean what you can take from him, receive the impartation of whatever, where if he says, like Elaine says, if he has two words, receive the impartation today, because that means something big's coming or he wouldn't be here, and prepare for what's next. But I'll thank you all. I want to welcome you for coming out here, welcome you from the great city of East Lansing, welcome you from this region, and everything that we need to succeed is already in this room. And prepare, after we finish this family reunion today, we get back to work to change this region and change this nation for better. Thank you very much.
I started walking back there with him. I just wanted to listen to him some more. All right, next,
want to introduce Representative Alyssa Slotkin. I got to say some things. They handed this to me and said, well, here's her bio on that. But she just is great, man. I'm so happy she got reelected. Representative Slotkin brings balance, brings commitment, brings knowledge, brings nonpartisanship, no matter what they say. She is the kind of elected official that I want to support because of that balance. Her work as a CIA officer, serving in Iraq, all the things that she has done around lowering the price of prescription drugs, and very important to Mary and I, is clean water and preserving our Great Lakes. It's one of our number one issues. Without that, we don't, Michigan, that's the secret sauce this state has, is our Great Lakes. I'm just glad a lot of other people don't know it yet. I'm just glad that she and Senator Stabenow are working hard to preserve it. So with that, I'd like to introduce Representative Slotkin.
Well, hello, people. Okay, I am keenly aware that I'm between you, Senator Stabenow, and your lunch. So we're going to bring some energy to this. I couldn't be happier to be back here at this event. It is good for Lansing to have this event. We missed it. We can clap for bringing the event back, people. It is an honor, of course, to join you on MLK Day, and I want to recognize the commission that has done such excellent work. It is hard to get this kind of thing done, and in particular, thank my friend Elaine Hardy for all of her leadership as the chairperson who works tirelessly. Yep, and maybe some remember a couple years ago when she got a surprise trip. We gave her a surprise trip. That was one of my favorite moments, was like being on a game show up here, and she got a surprise trip that was gifted to her. Also lovely to have an icon with us, Mr. Fred Gray. We're gonna recognize him properly, but I wanna do something now, if you'll give me permission, and recognize and acknowledge our senior senator from the state of Michigan, Debbie Stabenow. A few weeks ago, Senator Stabenow created a little earthquake in Michigan politics. She announced that she would not be running for office again in 2024. She has devoted the last 50 years nearly of her life to public service, representing this area, this community, since she was 23 years old. And I can list off every piece of important legislation that she's worked on, but I wanted to highlight a couple of areas that are really, that she has changed our lives in profound ways that you may not even be aware of. The senator has championed the Freedom to Vote Act and the John Lewis Voting Rights Advancement Act in the U.S. Senate. She led the effort to ensure that Michiganders have access to same-day voter registration and no reason absentee. Remember that? No reason absentee voting. She's helped deliver the single largest ever investment in our nation's water infrastructure, and she has fought through the Farm Bill and now as the chairwoman of the Agriculture Committee to ensure that our kids eat, they get meals at school when they need them. Now, we'll have lots of time to talk about Senator Stabenow. She's been a friend and a mentor to me. Her energy is endless, which is just kind of amazing. But I think the lesson that I take most importantly from her, and what I'd like to just touch on today at this event, is that there is no effective change without thoughtful planning. And we need activism combined with a plan to get things done in order to get things done now. And I think that dovetails perfectly into the theme of our event today. And I had the opportunity recently to go down in between Christmas and New Year's, and I visited the National Civil Rights Museum in Memphis, Tennessee. If you haven't heard of it, please put it on your bucket list. It is amazing. It's housed in the Lorraine Hotel where Martin Luther King was assassinated. It's an incredible museum. The line that was taken for our theme this year, now is the time to lift our nation from the quicksand of racial injustice to the solid rock of brotherhood. I went back and read the speech, and you can see it on display at the museum. And what was important is that in that sentence, the word now was italicized. Right? There was an emphasis put on the word now. Not next month, not next year, not when it's convenient, but now. And we can learn from Dr. King on that score because I think what he understood, and you can see it through this museum, is what history books often miss, that he had the heart behind the movement, but he also had the head. That there was no way that we could have gotten done what needed to get done with the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act without both the heart and the head. He had a plan. There was an agenda. There was a legal strategy. There was a financial strategy. There was money raising. There was a communication strategy. It was not just people who got fed up and decided that day to do something. There was a plan and a strategic agenda behind it. And I think the thing that catches my attention is that, or it caught my attention as I was walking through the museum, is that you can actually listen to a phone call between King and President Johnson. You literally can pick up a phone and it's a recorded conversation. And you understand that it was activism and leadership on display. They were pushing and pulling each other to talk about legislation that was going to change people's lives. It was pretty amazing. Mr. Johnson was a complicated man, a Southern Democrat, wouldn't have necessarily thought that he was going to do the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act. But he did it. And he did it because he was pushed and he used the tools of power to get things done. Frankly, that's an unbeatable combination, the heart and the head. And what I think the lesson for me as your elected representative, your representative in the U.S. House, is to always remember that whatever we do, we got to bring our heart and our head. One is not enough. So on this important day, I thank you for inviting me, as always, to the celebration. It gives everyone, including me, the opportunity to focus and recommit. And we do it because we always, always, always need the head and the heart. So thank you very much.
You hear what she just said? The head and the heart. You have to be awake for that to work, right? Next, I appreciate the fact Representative Slotkin did my introduction of the senator. So I'm just going to call our Senator Debbie Stabenow, our rock. We talk about the rock. She has been a rock for this state. I'd like to call out our Honorable Senator Debbie Stabenow.
Thank you so much. It's so wonderful to be here again. Oh my gosh. The largest, longest running MLK luncheon in the entire Great Lakes region. Country. Now it's the country. Elaine. All right. Well, it's so wonderful to be here. I appreciate so much our great Congresswoman Alyssa Slotkin's comments. Very, very kind. And I also want to say that I, too, want to give a shout-out to Mark McDaniel. You've seen why we all love him so much and why Elaine is such a wonderful partner with you. And I also want to remember our dear friend James Butler, who I was honored to speak at his service here, but also to be at Arlington National Cemetery. I don't know if Rashawn's here today, but he is buried in Arlington National Cemetery because of his military service. And so it was wonderful to have a top to be there. Our great Elaine Hardy, thank you so much. The MLK Commission extraordinary. I when you were talking about 30 years, I went, oh my gosh, I've been here all 30 of those years. I remember when we started. So it's wonderful. And to have our great mayors, of course, Mayor Schor, Mayor Bacon, it's so great to have this wonderful representation in Lansing and East Lansing. Thank you so much for all of you do. And what an honor to have Fred Gray with us. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Gray, for being with us. This is the day when we officially come together to commemorate the life and legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And as we know, he would be 94 years old. 94 years old. And as we know, 94 years after Dr. King's birth, when we think about his words, the concerns he expressed, sadly today, they are still with us. Even though we've been working hard, we make progress, and then we move forward, we move back, we move forward, we move back. And there's still people trying to divide us in new ways. I mean, he didn't have social media back then and what was happening. And we continue to have all of this spewed out in so many ways, people trying to divide us. We've got the pain of poverty, we've got violence in our communities, we've got the continuing scourge of racism. And while we're working together to create a safer, healthier, more just community, we know that these struggles will go on. And they will unfortunately go on beyond us. So finding solutions takes constant vigilance. That's why we're here. Constant effort now. Yet, I have to tell you, I find myself very hopeful in this moment about the possibilities of progress. As many of you know, last month, the current pastor of Dr. King's church, Reverend Raphael Warnock, was reelected to the United States Senate. It was wonderful to see President Biden speaking at his church yesterday. Senator Warnock is my friend, truly. He now sits on the Senate Agriculture and Nutrition Committee, and he and I were talking about 5 years ago when we did the last Farm Bill. He was protesting and got arrested because folks on the other side of the aisle were trying to cut food assistance for kids. And he now sits on the committee. And we're going to make sure that certainly does not happen, that our families and our children have the food that they need. So his presence in the Senate is a blessing. I'm so grateful, truly, that he was reelected as a senator. And that's thanks to Georgia's voters and the tireless people who work their heart out every day to organize, to get people to the polls. And it wasn't easy because so many states have made it harder for people to vote. Fortunately, we've done the opposite in Michigan, but in so many states, particularly Georgia. But people showed up. They waited in lines. They worked day and night to make every voice heard. And they were heard. Now, we saw the same dedication in Michigan, right? Our state just had the largest turnout for a midterm election ever, ever. We protected our freedom to vote. We protected our reproductive freedoms. We showed up. People waited in lines. They worked day and night to make sure that our voices were heard and Michiganders' voices were heard, because they believe, we believe together, that the possibilities of progress depend on us. That's why I'm hopeful. It does depend on us, and we're showing up, which is a great thing. We should be proud of that. And we elected an amazing group of young leaders, leaders who will be ready, I am confident, to carry on my work in the United States Senate when I step down in 2 years and pass the baton. Because we are showing up. We have people saying, sign me up. I'm not saying it's easy, but sign me up, because I want to be a part of this. Dr. King knew how important democracy is. As he said at the National Bar Association in 1959, the shape of the world today does not permit us the luxury of an anemic democracy. Then and now, we need a dynamic democracy where everybody is engaged and involved and believes in it. There are those who want to take away hope so we don't participate. They want to control the power by having everybody else feel like it doesn't matter. It does matter. We've shown it mattered. We've shown in Michigan how you can lead when you step in and believe it. And it matters. So, we have and we need to make sure that we have a democracy that is of all the people, by all the people, and for all the people. Thanks so much for being here today. It is always, always wonderful to share this time with you, and I want to thank you for everything that you are doing individually to keep Dr. King's dreams of a robust, dynamic democracy alive. It's my honor to be your partner.
All right, well, we are now going to break for lunch. And while we are having lunch, we're going to call on Mr. Rodney Page to entertain us with his music.
So Dr. King's legacy is really rooted in what we're doing for the next generation of activists and organizers. And I love that we always are intentional about including high school students, middle school students in today's program, because quite honestly, they're going to be the ones that are dealing with the challenges of tomorrow. And so I'm excited that we continue that legacy that's spread down to our young people.
It's always special because as the older, you know, his legacy lives, less people, especially our younger people, don't know about it. So to bring awareness for events like this and also to fight the anti-critical race theory people so that we can learn about our history and how it affects us today. So it's always good to celebrate his legacy and as it lives on.
All right. Now, I'd like to introduce Commissioner Tony Baltimore, who will lead the King Legacy Service and Awards presentation.
Good afternoon again. Good afternoon again. Thank you. What a wonderful program. It is so good to be back here with all of you. I have someone special behind me that's going to help me present this next award, our King Legacy Award. It is our most prestigious award, and we're very proud of to give this to an individual who has made an impact on this community. But before I say that, it would be strange for me to show up in the Romney building tomorrow. I think the governor would be surprised to see that her lieutenant governor is shorter and healthier. So, but thanks, Mark, for that promotion, I think. Anyway, without further ado, we want to present the 2023 King Legacy Award to none other than Barbara Roberts Mason.
Thank you.
Come on, you all can do better than that. Miss Mason's, as you can imagine, Miss Mason's biography is about 82 pages long. We don't have time for all of it, but I did take out a few excerpts, and it's Barbara Roberts Mason, named by the Lansing State Journal as one of the 100 most influential people of the millennial, 12/31/1999. After high school, she received a BA and MA degrees and completed doctoral coursework at MSU. Go green. In 1971, Mason was hired by the MEA as the first African American and first female executive director of the Lansing Schools Education Association, and later the first at Lansing Community College, Waverly Public Schools, and the Clinton County Education Association. In 1987, Mason founded the Black Child and Family Institute of Lansing. BCFI is now called Building Child and Family Initiatives, Inc., and continues to offer quality programs for children, youth, and adults. Ms. Mason's leadership has been recognized on local, state, and international levels. She has received many recognitions. She has also led delegations to countries such as Germany, France, Korea, China, Ghana, Cameroon, Nigeria, and South Africa. I'm telling you, this thing is long. In 1974, she became the first African-American woman to be elected to a statewide office when she was elected to the State Board of Education. She served on the board for 24 years and served as president twice. She is also proud to have been inducted into the Michigan Historical Women's Hall of Fame in 2014. Mason's greatest joy is spending time with her children and grandchildren, Roger Roberts, a physicist, Lauren Thomas, an attorney, Bella Thomas, Central State Ohio University junior, Mikey Thomas, Holt High School senior, and Angelina Thomas, Holt eighth grader. They are members of Trinity AME Church in Lansing, where she serves as a member of the steward board and lay organizations. She also is active and lifelong member of the Missionary Society. Barbara Roberts Mason knows she has done a lot, but says, I always believe I can do more. Ladies and gentlemen, Barbara Roberts Mason.
All I can say is I am truly surprised. Tony asked me when I came in if I would come and help Debbie Stabenow and Alyssa Slotkin present an award, but he didn't say who the award was for. And I said, well, will I have to say anything? He says, no, just to help present it. So I had no idea why I'm here or why I was coming up here. But I can't think of a more prestigious or precious award to receive, and from a greater group than this one. It reminds me of the city of Lansing's noon Martin Luther King presentations, because believe it or not, historically speaking, doesn't show my age or anything, I was the first speaker for those luncheon, those noontime sessions. All I will say right now is this is a very important day, and it's a very important time in our history. And the one thing that I remember most about Dr. King saying is when he talked about King George, who went to sleep on a mountain, and when he woke up, this country belonged to another George. And he said, the one thing that we did, and the people did then, was sleep through a revolution. A revolution that was taking place at that time, the Revolutionary War. Well, there's another revolution taking place right now, right here, in our city, in our country, and really, globally. And we cannot afford to sleep through this resolution. So all I can say, as you were talking about being woke, we have to stay awake. We cannot go to sleep. So let us all, from this day forward, remember that we cannot sleep through this revolution. And let me just say to the commission, I'm so pleased and grateful and honored to receive this award today. Thank you, everybody. This is my child. Shall I spank him?
Now I'm going to introduce Elaine Hardy for another special presentation.
Seems like we need some like Emmy walking music or something. It's too quiet. I am up here just for 2 seconds to tell you that the commission is not arbitrary when we give honors to people. It is a thoughtful deliberation by our commission. And these next two awards, we don't give out every year. As a matter of fact, I think the last person to receive one was Dick Pefley for his work in helping with the Flint water crisis. And so I have the absolute honor to ask Senator Stabenow if she would come out and help us to present what is dear to the commission and known as our Keeper of the Dream Awards.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Well, thank you so much, Elaine. It really is an honor to have an opportunity to present this award, the Keeper of the Dream Award. Also someone who I think is not knowing this is going to happen, so it's always fun to do surprises, right? So let me present the Keeper of the Dream Award, and I will talk a little bit about him before he is coming up. But this goes to Michigan House Speaker Joe Tate. A proud Detroit native, Speaker Tate was elected in 2018 to represent his hometown in the state legislature. Of course, he's no stranger to Lansing. He was a star offensive lineman and later a coach for the Spartans. Go Green! He also served in the Marines, leading a platoon in Afghanistan. He's truly becoming a rising star in our state, first serving as minority vice chair of the House Appropriations Committee in only his second term. And now he's making history as the first black House speaker in Michigan history. I know he hopes to use his leadership to address gun violence and defend labor rights and protect reproductive choice and move our economy forward and make sure everybody's got a fair shot to succeed in our great state. And I'm very excited to welcome the recipient of this year's Keeper of the Dream Award, Speaker Joe Tate.
Good afternoon, everyone. I can take my glasses off because I don't have any remarks prepared. So, and I like to follow the three B's whenever I step up. Brother, be brief. So I want to thank the Commission of Mid-Michigan, to Senator Stabenow for this award, and I'm going to plagiarize a little bit just from Mayor Bacon just saying, you know, essentially I'm here because I'm standing on the shoulders of giants, and looking forward to hearing from Mr. Gray and his remarks and all of the work that he's done for civil rights and injustice across the state of Michigan. And I'm reading a book right now. It's called Waging a Good War by Tom Ricks. And it goes through the civil rights journey from the 40s through the 60s. And being an officer, a former officer in the Marine Corps, back in the 1940s, they treated in America German POWs better than they treated blacks, black officers coming back home in the South. And for us to be at this point, is just profound. And that's because of the work of, those at Mr. Gray and Martin Luther King and Mother Rosa Parks, and all of the work they've done. But also knowing as well too that, we still have a lot of work to do here, not only across the country, but in the United States. So I'm looking forward to getting to work with my colleagues in the Michigan Steakhouse, and thank you again for this award. Thank you.
Hello, everyone, again. Well, we did these awards. The commission had the idea to do these awards secretly, and so they really did not know this was coming, which I think is a pretty fun thing. I have the distinct honor of presenting this award to a public servant, a colleague, and a friend, one who serves the community she grew up in with passion and commitment, Senator Sarah Anthony. As a graduate of Everett High School on the city's south side, Sarah received her... Sarah received her bachelor's in political science and legal studies from Central Michigan and later her master's from Western Michigan. After graduation, she immediately returned to Lansing to serve under former State Representative Joan Bauer as a legislative assistant, so she was already planning and plotting, working closely with the residents to streamline government services. In 2010, Sarah began her 8 years of service as the deputy director of the Michigan College Access Network, and in 2012 became the youngest African-American woman to ever serve on a board of commissioners in the country, and she was elected to the Ingham County Board of Commissioners. And as you all know, Sarah has never looked back. She's been shattering glass ceilings ever since, the first African-American woman to serve as Lansing's state representative, and now, with this new term, the first African-American woman to represent mid-Michigan in the state Senate. And in case you haven't heard, her appointment as the chair of the Senate Appropriations Committee is also historic. Throughout her time in public service thus far, Sarah has earned a reputation as a pragmatic, effective legislator, laser-focused on her priorities to strengthen education, expand healthcare, reform our criminal justice system, fight to end discrimination, and then through really groundbreaking legislations like the Crown Act, which kind of went viral and went all over the country, to improve the economy for working families here in Michigan. I think more importantly than all those accolades, though, is Sarah is someone who listens. She's one of those people when we're just sitting across the table from each other, we lock eyes and we just understand each other. She understands the needs of our community and the people around her. So we talked earlier about the head and the heart. She has the head, the heart, and the hands. So please help me in congratulating Sarah Anthony.
Go ahead, sit. I have no remarks at all. I was half asleep when I walked in, and this is just truly an honor. I have been attending this luncheon since I was in high school, normally in the back, trying to finagle my way into someone's table. And when I started working with Joan Bauer, we finally actually got like a paid
like seats at the table. And I was always in awe of how many power players and business owners and government officials would make their way to the Lansing Center to honor the legacy of Dr. King. And a few years ago, I picked up a book. It's called The Death of a King by Tavis Smiley. And it talks about the last year of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s life. And it wasn't a pretty one. He was depressed. Most folks in the movement had turned their backs on him. They thought that he was going too far, that he was starting to tackle the really difficult things. You know, we know him for his work on human and civil rights and race relations, but he started to think broader. He started to want to tackle the issues of militarism and poverty. And it's something interesting when you step out of the box that people have put you in. And when it gets really, really difficult, you notice that most folks stop giving you big awards and accolades because it gets really hard. Now, we know that there are many of us, some that have fancy titles and some that do not, that continue to do the really hard work in our community. You know, like showing up at someone's home after a loved one has been gunned down senselessly with a plate of food and just time to just mourn and grieve. Or when you start to think of the conditions of our community and think, why is it that in progressive pockets across the country and across Michigan, that African Americans continue to lag behind in terms of jobs and healthcare disparities? We still haven't quite reached that place that Martin Luther King so eloquently said that he would get to that mountaintop. Maybe not with us, but that surely he would get there. So usually in this room, I sit back and I look at all of the local African Americans who are serving in positions of power, like school board members who never quite graced the stage, like Robin Lewis and Shirley Rogers, folks like Melanie Lynn, who is serving in Okemos, folks like Ashley Kirkendall in Grand Ledge, in Mason, as we saw former city council member Marlon Brown. These are folks who are usually the only person that looks like them at the table and have to carry the weight of ensuring that equity and inclusion and diversity reaches every pocket of our respective vineyards. So instead of me dedicating this to folks with very fancy titles, I want to dedicate this to the folks who are doing the real work in our community, who often are not looked at and are not celebrated. This is for you. So to the Sunday school teachers, to our law enforcement and to our firefighters, to folks who are volunteering at the mission right now, I say this is for you. Thank you for serving, not just on Martin Luther King Day, but on every single day of the year. God bless you all. This is for you.
All right, we're now going to move into our essay and scholarship part of the program. This is one of my favorite parts. So for this part, I would like to introduce Angela Brown, who's with MSU Federal Credit Union.
Good afternoon. My name is Angela Brown. I'm the past chair of the board of directors for the MSU Federal Credit Union. On behalf of April Klobas, CEO and president, and the board of directors, our members, and our employees, I would like to thank the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Commission of Mid-Michigan for their leadership in celebrating the legacy of Dr. King's teachings and for reminding us that his philosophy of love, tolerance, and nonviolence is still relevant today. MSU-FCU joins the commission in working to achieve these ideals by promoting diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging, and by facilitating social improvements in our community. To foster this effort, MSU-FCU relies on the incredible work and contributions of many, including our DEI employees, our DEI Employee Council, our employee affinity groups, and employees at all levels of the credit union. MSU-FCU is proud to sponsor the 2023 Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Commission of Mid-Michigan Essay Contest. Students from across the region participated and wrote to the theme, "Now is the time to lift ourselves from the quicksands of social injustice to the solid rock of brotherhood." And we've heard that quite a bit today. These are words Dr. King spoke nearly 60 years ago, yet they remain relevant now in our work towards full inclusion and equity. Please help me in congratulating our winners. I'm going to announce the winners, third, second, and then first in each category. And we will have one of our winners read her essay. In the sixth to eighth grade category, Jack Bingle, Hazlitt, eighth grader, third place in the essay contest. Second place, Gabriella Lehman, Hazlitt, eighth grade. And in first place, Addison Schroeder, Hazlitt, eighth grade. And Addison will read her essay.
On August 28, 1963, a business owner in Washington, D.C. was getting ready to open her store. She was playing the radio and singing along to the songs. She thought that it was a normal day, but she would later come to realize that this day would go down in history and change her life. The radio stopped playing music and it started playing a speech. She thought she had heard him before but wasn't sure. She heard people cheering. Why was this guy so popular, she thought. Why were so many people cheering for him? As she listened to the speech, she knew it was another black speaker, but this time she listened. She didn't change the channel or turn it down. She turned it up. She got swept away in the words as he spoke, but this one sentence hit her hard. Now is the time to lift our nation out of the quicksand of racial injustice to the solid rock of brotherhood. This sentence made her stop what she was doing. She thought about it. Was she the quicksand? Was she pulling people down instead of lifting them up? She thought about all the things that had happened. She thought about the times when black people were being harassed and sprayed with fire hoses. She thought about the times when black people came into her shop tired and in need of a job, and she turned them away. She realized that she was part of something she didn't want to be, so she started hiring African Americans to work for her. She was frowned upon by many, but she didn't care. She lost some people, but strengthened relationships with others. She was proud to be helping hardworking people and their families live a better life.
Thank you, Addison. Now for the 9th through 11th grade, Seth Boyer, Sexton, 11th grade, third place. Marielle Saxon Garman, Sexton, 11th grade, second place. Zainab Al Rabia, Sexton, 11th grade, first place.
She's not here.
Unfortunately, Zainab needed to leave, but please join me in congratulating her and all of our winners today. Thank you.
Next, we'll recognize the high school winners of their essays, and these are four college scholarships. First of all, Rashawn. Is Rashawn Butler there? Yeah, come on out. I went to the commission last year, and I went to them. And I said, I'm asking you for permission. If you don't give it to me, I'm still going to do it. But as I said earlier, James Butler was a very important person, not just to me, but this community. Rashawn was a teacher. James believed in education of our young people. You know, he was a very quiet force in this community until he had to be a tough force. He could do both. So what I asked was, I wanted to change this award, the name of this award, to the James Butler III and Mark McDaniel Scholarship Fund. So from here on out, James will have his legacy recognized about the importance of education for our youth. And I asked Rashawn to be up here. I hope she's up here every year with me.
Absolutely.
To make these awards for our winners. Our first is Nina Long. From East Lansing High School. And before I want to give you an overview, I read all these, and they every year they're wonderful. But this year, I don't know, it was just something uniquely different. The depth of what I felt in reading these, actually, I was moved. And just a couple little excerpts here. I'm not going to say who did what here, but one talked about the quicksand analogy. So quicksand traps and consumes its victims quickly, just as hatred can consume us if we are not careful. This person experienced racial injustice in her school because of the color of her skin. In those moments, what I most recall is standing alone. Her grandmother told her, though, would always tell her, people can take many things from you, but they cannot take your education. Another is, I believe I should be considered for the scholarship because I understand the sacrifices that were made for me to be where I am, and because I plan to utilize every opportunity I have to change the world for better. Another was an example of what it's like being here. I have to not only work harder to prove something, but I also have to keep a smile on my face all of the time. If not, I have, oh my God, I thought you were so rude. Or as soon as I stand up for something, I'm finally the angry black woman they want me to be. If I'm quiet, that means I'm stuck up. If I'm too loud, I'm extremely ghetto. So what I'm saying is, this scholarship is going to help me not only be my real self, but also help me find the perfect safe place for me, which would be at a historic black college and university. So our first award with Nina. Hi, sorry, I made you stand there a little bit longer. Hey, hi. All right. Go
no, you're still with me.
All right, next. Oh my. I went and got out of order. Is Kennedy Duncan from East Lansing. Next is Zai Hall from Bath. And our finalist from DeWitt, Abigail Fouchard. There's something, when I read these, they're every year they're always special, but I don't know, there's just something this year that struck me, and especially as I read Zai's and everybody else's, is that I want to do something, and some of this is related now to James being with us, but every one of you is going to get a $5,000 scholarship from us. So now, I want to introduce our next person who's going to introduce our keynote speaker, which I'm sure Mr. Gray's happy about this finally happening. but I want to introduce a person, you'll know, if you know Danielle. She is a person filled with joy and a huge heart. And when she walks into a room, it lights up. And so I'd like to introduce Danielle Robinson from Jackson National.
Well, good afternoon. I am Danielle Robinson, and on behalf of Jackson's 3,800 associates across the country, may I say it is our pleasure to once again support the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. holiday events each year. But more than that, to support diversity, equity, and inclusion in our workplace all year long. With me, thank you. With me today, I have members of Jackson's Employee Resource Group VIBE, or Visions in Black Excellence. These associates and their important work are just one example of Jackson's commitment to maintaining a culture of respect where all associates can contribute toward our company's purpose to help Americans achieve financial freedom for life. Today, I am delighted to tell you about our esteemed keynote, Fred David Gray, a pioneer of the civil rights movement. Mr. Gray is a native of Montgomery, Alabama, who currently lives in Tuskegee, Alabama, with his wife, Carol. He is also one of the few courageous Black lawyers who risked their lives to attack segregation in the court. And we've heard it twice already, but at 92 years old, amazing, right? He holds several bar affiliations and continues to practice law, specializing in civil rights litigation with a legal career spanning over 68 years. That's amazing. Mr. Gray is both a lawyer and an ordained minister in the Church of Christ. He is a past president of the National Bar Association and was the first African-American president of the Alabama State Bar. His first civil rights case was the representation of Claudette Colvin, a 15-year-old African-American high school student who refused to give up her seat on a city bus in Montgomery, Alabama in March of 1955. In December of 1955, he represented Miss Rosa Parks, who was arrested because she refused to give up her seat on a bus to a white man. He was also Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s first civil rights attorney. The list of civil rights cases he has won are numerous and are included in many legal textbooks. And even being a non-attorney myself, I can tell we can all learn something important from Mr. Gray. On July 7th, 2022, President Joe Biden awarded Mr. Gray with the Presidential Medal of Freedom, this country's highest award for a civilian. Mr. Gray's life mission has been to stamp out discrimination, and that is what he continues to do. So I think you will all agree we are in store for a treat today. Please help me give a warm Lansing welcome to Fred Gray.
Good afternoon. Thank you for a wonderful introduction. They tell me that introductions like that sometimes is good to rub on, but not to take in. But I want to thank you very much. Thanks to Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Commission of Mid-Michigan and for the invitation to speak here to you this afternoon. I am particularly appreciative to those persons who have worked very closely with me in making it a pleasant and enjoyable trip. Miss Elaine Hardy, who has been right here and done everything. First conversation I think I had was Mr. Lee June. And I just want to thank all of the members of the commission who have made this event what it is and invited me here. Give yourselves a hand. I want to thank my wife, Carol, who's here with me. We are both second marriages. I'd been married to my first wife for over 40 years. She had been married to her first husband for over 30 years, and we had some mutual friends and met at a church function, and they thought we needed to know each other, and we now have been married for over 22 years. Thank you. And I want to thank every one of you who are here. There may be some other persons out there who has been We've gotten a text or so from my son saying that some classmate of his, who needs a lawyer in our office, is here. But all of those persons who had anything to do with, or I need to particularly acknowledge you, I acknowledge you. Thank you. To speak about Dr. King, and you've heard a lot about Dr. King, and one thing I don't think I'm going to do is do a whole lot of talking about Dr. King. You've read about it. I've read the resolutions that's in your program. You've heard the speakers talk about it. And I hope to tell you a few things that you may not know about my relationship with him and his relationship to the Montgomery Improvement Association and his trial that started when no one knew about him in March of 1956. But at the end of it, he was known around the world and then went ahead and finally have a holiday in his honor. But first, I want to speak a little bit about why Dr. King's holiday means so much to me. I happen to be one of two persons who introduced Dr. King to the African American community after Mrs. Parks was arrested on December 1st, and that arrest occurred after Mrs. Parks and I had been having conferences in my office for almost a year. But when she was arrested, and when the time came and she had left word that she wanted me to represent her, and after we had had our conference that we had been having for almost a year on December 1st, we had talked about what persons should do if they were asked to get up their seats on a bus, and she knew what we had talked about. She also knew on that day that I was going to be out of town immediately after our message, our meeting. I left town. Mrs. Rosa Parks went back to the Montgomery Fair to work. And little did I know, when I got back, I had calls from Mrs. Parks. And I had calls from my office staff, and they told me that Ms. Parks had been arrested. I had a call from her, and she wanted me to come over to her house and talk to us. This is in the afternoon of December 1st. I went to Mrs. Parks' house. She told me what had happened. This was on Thursday afternoon. She told me that her trial was the following Monday morning at 8:30 in the Recorder's Court of the City of Montgomery, and she wanted me to represent her. And I said, Miss, and then she told me the details. I said, well, Miss Parks, I appreciate that. We'll get back together over the weekend and we'll be ready to go to trial on Monday. But I also told her, so you know, Miss Parks, we've had a lot of trouble on buses. And Joanne Robinson, who is a professor of English at Alabama State, had been arrested back in 1948 on a similar situation. But she was interested in the community getting involved so that not only we have the legal aspect, but get the community involved so that we won't have this problem anymore. And I told Mrs. Parks, I said, I'm going to go and talk to Ms. Robinson and see whether or not we can get the community ready by December, by Monday, to do that. Mr. Nixon had already gotten out of jail. He had signed the bond. I went to his house. Mr. Nixon was really Mr. Civil Rights in Montgomery at that time. And I told him, I said, Mr. Nixon, we really appreciate what you've done for Rosa Parks. And she was secretary to the NAACP, and she was also chairman of the youth committee. But I said, you know, Ms. Robinson wants the community involved. Well, E.D. Nixon was a Pullman compoter. He was in town 3 days and out of town 3 days. This is Thursday, and he's going to have to leave the next day to go on the trip, going up to Chicago, and wouldn't be back. So I went by his house, and he says, well, lawyer, I've gotten her out of jail. Ms. Parks' case is going to be set. You go on and talk to Joanne Robinson. And if you all decide that we need to do something else, let me know so I can set the plans up with the chairman of the ministerial alliance so that whatever needs to be done after Mrs. Parks' arrest on Monday, we'll be able to do it. I left Mr. Nixon's house and I went to Joanne Robinson's house. She lived on the other side of town where Alabama State is located. And all of what I'm telling you about this, you can find it in our book, Bus Ride to Justice, my autobiography, on pages 50 and 52. What she ended up, we sat in her living room and concluded that one, if we're going to ever get the community involved in Montgomery, now is the time to do it. And then she says, and I said, well, Ms. Parks, ultimately it's going to take a lawsuit, and it takes a long time for lawsuits. She said, well, why don't we just say we're going to stay off of the buses for 1 day, and then where we go from there? Well, I said, well, that's fine, but if it's successful, and we hope it's successful, if they stay off on Monday, the day of the trial, what about Tuesday and Wednesday and the next day until they return on a non-segregated basis? Well, I said, well, if that's the case, we got to make a few more plans than just for 1 day. And we concluded that, one, if we're going to do that, we've got to be able to have a spokesman to speak for the people. They need to speak to the black folks to encourage them to stay off of the buses. They need to speak for the persons on the other side who's against what we're doing. And Joanne said, well, Fred, I'll tell you, we need somebody who can move men, move people with words. And said, my pastor, Martin Luther King Jr., is the one who we need to get to be the spokesman. I said, that's fine. I'd met Dr. King, but I didn't know her like she did. She was a member of this church. But I said, if you do that, you've got to do a couple of other things. One, you got to get all these preachers involved because at that time, people were going to church on Sunday. A lot of them not going now. So you need one more thing. You just might need a lawyer. Here am I, send me. When the word got out, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was appointed to be the spokesman for the group before he got to the meeting. Rufus Lewis was appointed chairman of the Transportation Committee. E.D. Nixon was appointed treasurer. And Fred Gray, the young lawyer out of law school, just out about a year, was the lawyer to be responsible for the legal work. When the message got out, and when they had the official meeting, everything that Fred Gray and Joanne Robinson had recommended to the community took place. And when Dr. Martin Luther King spoke at the Holt Street Baptist Church that night with thousands of people there, we knew we were right, and the rest of it's history. Now, there were several other reasons for it. Dr. King had not been in Montgomery long. He had just become the pastor of Dexter Avenue Baptist Church on the first Sunday in September of 1954. And guess what else happened that same week? On the 7th of September of 1954, Fred Gray was admitted by the Alabama Supreme Court to be able to practice law in the state of Alabama. So you have those two. Dr. King had never been involved in civil rights activities. Fred Gray was just in law school. But it set the pattern for where we are. But another reason, and I'll come back to this other in just a moment, because I want to tell you two or three things, and I know you've been here a long time. But what we decided was that we were going to meet, and we met. And then when the trial took place, we now must keep the people off of the buses, and they were able to stay off of the buses that long. But there's another reason why this day, the King's holiday, means so much to me, is because jumping forward a while to 1973, after I had been elected as one of the first two blacks to serve in the Alabama Reconstruction, in November, I pre-filed a bill in the Alabama legislature to make the third Monday in January of each year a holiday in the state of Alabama in order to honor Dr. Martin Luther King. Guess what happened to my bill? It never got out of committee. However, years later, almost 10 years later, other congressmen in the Congress, state legislators across the country, introduced a bill that ultimately resulted in our celebrating today the holiday. But I want you to know that that bill that Fred Gray filed was one of the earliest bills filed in any legislature. So I'm very happy to be here. I'm going to just mention a few other things, and hopefully I'll have sense enough to know when to stop. One thing I want to say a few things about is the civil rights movement, by first giving you a historical perspective of why it became necessary for African Americans to work so hard since Reconstruction today in order to really be first-class citizens. And some of us have forgotten about it, and I won't take the time to go through the whole history, but I'll just mention it. But it took a while from slavery in, 1609 until today to see where we are. Then I'll just tell you, just mention, and I've already told you, basically about the Civil Rights Movement and how it started. And also, I'll just mention in passing the fact that what Joanne Robinson and I did in her living room and what the 50,000 African Americans did in Montgomery for 382 days, which resulted in the modern Civil Rights Movement and helped to change us up to a great deal. But I want you to know that there's trouble in the land now. And that while we have made a lot of progress, we kind of want to look at ourselves today and see where do we go from here, because things are not, don't look as good as they did at one time. I think all of us know, and I don't need to tell you, that African Americans were the only ethnic group that was brought to this country without their permission. While America is considered the melting pot of the world, and people have come to this country for all types of freedoms, with respect to African Americans, we were brought here against our will. And if this country had really lived up to the Constitution, where it talks about all men and the Declaration of Independence created equal, if we had lived up to that, it wouldn't have been necessary to have a civil rights movement. But we the people, in the preamble to the Constitution as originally written and adopted, did not include people who looked like me. The drafters of the Constitution and the Declaration of Rights and Grievances and the Declaration of Independence as originally adopted were not concerned about people who looked like me or minorities, particularly black people. They were only concerned about white Americans, and I might add, only white male Americans, because white women had to work to get the right to vote just like black people. It therefore became necessary for Africans to have any rights. The 13th Amendment was adopted in 1865. Which abolished slavery. The 14th Amendment was adopted in 1868, which made African American citizens and extended to them due process and equal protection of the laws. And now there are more white people in this country who receive rights under the 14th Amendment than black people, because there's more of them. And the 15th Amendment, ratified in 1870, prohibited the denial of voting rights on the basis of race, and voting rights for us to remain voted or getting to be voted has gotten back to be a main reason, and we've got to work to finish the task. If this country had been true to its creed, it would resolve the problems of solving that when the 15th Amendment, but it wasn't. And when John Lewis and Hosea Williams and Amelia Barrington and others were beaten back in Selma on March 7, 1965, and when they were beaten back on what is called Bloody Monday, they got on the phone and called Fred Gray. And I went to Selma, they retained me. And before the close of day on Monday, the next day, we had filed the lawsuit of Williams versus Governor Wallace on March 7th, on March 8th. One day afterwards, I filed that suit, and it was able to enable these people to march from Selma to Montgomery, and it helped to pass the Voting Rights of 1965. That should have solved the problem. But it didn't. I'm not going to tell you, and you might think that with all these segregation cases that have been involved, and I really meant to get one other thing that I passed, let me just mention it and tell you how I got involved in the civil rights movement, then I won't have to do it a little later. When I grew up as a teenager in Montgomery, there were about two things that black boys could do. Be a preacher and a teacher, and either way you did it, you had to do it on a segregated basis. I decided I'd be both, went to a church school, came back to Montgomery to learn how to be a, I went up there to Nashville to learn how to be a preacher, came back to Montgomery to learn how to be a teacher. And I found that our people were being discriminated against, and I found everything was completely segregated. So I decided as a teenager, they told me that lawyers help people to solve problems. So I was going to go to law school, finish law school, come back to Alabama, pass the Alabama bar exam, become a lawyer, and destroy everything segregated I could find. And for 68 years, that's what I've been trying to do. Now you know how I became involved. So it wasn't anything that anybody forced me to do. For the past 69 years, I have devoted all of my adult life toward enforcing the rights of African Americans to enjoy those rights and privileges as proclaimed in the 13th, 14th, 15th Amendment to the Constitution to the United States. And most of that, most persons now, these historians agree that the civil rights movement in Montgomery, Alabama, was probably the key toward the beginning of the current right movement. I'm glad I was able to recommend that Dr. King do it. We did it. Later on, he was tried for violating the anti-boycott statute in March of 1956. And after he finished, and when we concluded the Montgomery bus boycott, Dr. King then did not have an organization to lead, because the Montgomery Improvement Association just dealt with buses and we were over. But he started the Southern Christian Leadership with three ministers from Alabama. And so you have the civil rights beginning to move and move along. And it moved and did well all of those years. And not only did he do that, and you heard all of these other things, but I want you to know that what we did during the Montgomery bus boycott, and you've heard about Claudette Colvin being my first civil rights case, and you know all about what Mrs. Rosa Parks have done in helping to make all these things possible. I've told you about how Mrs. Parks did what she did. And when you get down to it, the question that stands before us today, and it's something I think that we need to seriously think about. But before I get to that, I just want to congratulate these young people and congratulate this organization for having done what you have done for them. It was the young people, it was Claudette Colvin, who was 15, who was my first civil rights case. It was the kids up in North Carolina who started the sit-in demonstrations, for lunch counter demonstrations. It was SNCC and it was CORE who worked in Selma for the purpose of getting people right to vote. So I say to these young people, we congratulate you, but you have good people who were young when you were, who were doing things which needed to be done. So you're going to have to, if it's going to be completed, young ladies and young gentlemen, you must do everything you can. And what we as adults must do is everything to encourage these young people to do it. I don't have to tell you that the Civil Rights Movement was instrumental in electing the 44th and 42nd President of the United States. And I'm delighted that the President saw fit to give me the Medal of Freedom Award. Two years from now, we're going to have another presidential election, and we're going to have to really work to get the right person there. You've heard about and you read about Dr. King's dream, and I'm not going to dwell on it, but you know, there's one thing about a dream. The first thing you must do if you want a dream to come true is to what? Wake up. As long as you stay asleep, you don't make it. If we don't wake up today where we are and look at these real serious problems that we have, we're gonna miss it. So wake up. Now then, the current civil rights movement began with the arrest of my friend and client, Rosa Parks, on December 1st, 1955. Her arrest and the leadership of Dr. Martin Luther King, we celebrate that birthday today. As I indicated in my autobiography, Bus Ride to Justice, that it all started on a bus. However, the struggle continues. Notwithstanding our progress in recent years, we have seen an increase in racism, including the burning of churches and resurgence of hate groups all over the nation. This activity increased while Mr. Obama was in the presidency. It has continued and has increased since we inaugurated a new president a few years ago. The United States Supreme Court, for over a quarter of a century, pioneered the rights of minorities, including women. But in recent years, there has been a change, and the court, as it is now constituted, is beginning to reverse many of those principles, including the Shelby County case, which declared unconstitutional a part of the Voting Rights Act of 1965 that we were interested in, instrumental in passing. The Supreme Court has reversed itself on the right to have abortions. During the last 2 years, many states have passed laws which have resulted in making it more difficult to vote instead of making it easy. We have also seen these local district courts doing the same thing. What does what I have discussed with you today mean as we meet here at this Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Day Celebration Luncheon on January the 16th, 2023? It's simple. It means the struggle continues for equal justice under the law. I want to get ready to think about considering the possibility of closing in a minute. But before I do that, I want to tell you something else. and that is that we have a whole of these three generations of people who don't know about hardcore segregation. We need to teach them. I think our senator mentioned about the museum that's in Memphis. It's a wonderful museum. And there are national museums all over the country. But we have in Tuskegee, Alabama, one of the best small museums in the country, and we want to invite you to come and visit it. It tells you about the contributions made by the three ethnic groups that started this country: Native Americans, Americans of European descent, and Americans of African descent, all under one roof. If you come and see which each has done, you'll conclude they have contributed toward where we are and helped to make this country what it is. Secondly, that museum, the men in the infamous Tuskegee Syphilis Study, and I represented those men after I was able to get their case settled and able to get President Clinton to make an apology to him. Mr. Schor at the White House announced on the 16th of May, 1997, that we have formed the Tuskegee Human and Civil Rights Multicultural Center in Tuskegee to serve as a permanent memorial for us. And he asked the president to help him with it. For 25 years now, we have a permanent memorial there where you can see those various things. And then the third thing that that museum does, it gives a brief history of a struggle that African Americans have had to encounter from slavery time to today. It gives you all the constitutional amendments. It gives you all the federal, the congressional laws. You can see and hear, and there were four cases filed by residents of Macon County that has helped all around, including a law that prohibits discrimination and farm subsidies. You know about the Gomillion v. Lightfoot, the voting rights cases started in Montgomery in 1948, and it also enables African Americans to serve on civil juries. All these are things that were done. Now, you have said a great deal about Fred Gray, and you have honored me, and I appreciate that. But you know what? Do you really want to know what Fred Gray would appreciate what you're doing if you would do it? And first of all, I want to thank this organization. This organization has contributed a substantial amount to the Tuskegee Human and Civil Rights Multicultural Center. And guess what? I want to ask every one of you to do the same thing. And come and see it. I have a few little cards here that we'll have if you want to see some more about it. But the point is, if you want to express appreciation to them, and I think Dr. King would want you, if he were here, would want to help the people in Tuskegee, because the struggle when it was going on, when they put black people out of the city limits of Tuskegee to keep them from voting, he came over and spoke. So I think his message would be to help not only support that museum, but support all these others and to do everything that we need to do. Now then, what does what I have discussed with you today mean to those of us who are here this afternoon? I want to leave you with a challenge. If what I have said to you mean anything, it means, unfortunately, that racism and inequality is still alive in this country. Racism and inequality is what brought African Americans here. While we have chipped away at it from slavery till now, and with the current things that are going on in this country, we're in a very, very serious state. We're going to have to do more than just come here and do more than just make speeches. I can't tell you all of what you need to know, but I've told you about some of the things that we did in the Montgomery bus boycott, and if it can help you, use it. But you can find some things even better. If the life and work of Dr. King means anything, it means that the struggle continues for equal justice under the law, particularly for women and minorities. It means that there's a real chance as to whether the gains we have obtained will continue or whether we'll lose them. If we lose, it means that Dr. King and all those others who have given their lives for the protection of human and civil rights will have died in vain. If we lose, the nation loses. The struggle has not ended. Racial discrimination in this country has not ended. We do not have a level playing field. There is no such thing as a race-neutral society in America. The consequences of over 350 years of slavery, segregation, discrimination has not disappeared in the last years since the Civil Rights Movement. And it means that we need to wake up. Unfortunately, discrimination against African Americans and other minorities is still alive, and we need to do something about it. The question then is, where do we go from here? I want to suggest at least four things, and you can think of more. One, you must recognize that racism and inequality is still in existence. It's wrong, and people need to say it's wrong. That message needs to start at the White House, the Congress, the Supreme Court, all of our CEOs and institutions of higher learning. They need to say that racism and inequality is wrong. But just to say it's wrong is not enough. You must do as we did in Montgomery when we recognized that we were being mistreated. We came up with a plan. And if Joanne Robinson and I had not done the planning we did when we did it, there may not have been a Montgomery bus boycott then. But what I'm saying is, you can't just jump out here and do something. You are going to have to make plans. But you know what? Plans are good, but they have to be implemented. And not only must they be implemented, but we need to each individually realize that we'd all like for everything to be fine and all these problems are over, but it's not going to happen that way. We are going to have to get involved in helping to do it. So what I'm saying, we need to recognize the problem. Two, we need to come up with a plan. Three, we need to execute the plans. Four, each one of us needs to do what we can do. And finally, and I think I'm about there, but let me just say to each one of you, you are a leader in your community. That's why you're here. The challenge to yourselves is to leave here today more committed than when you came. More challenged to use what we use from the Civil Rights Movement to lead change in your own community in 20 and 23. I leave you today with a message that Congressman Lewis left with me. I first met Congressman Lewis in 1948. Dr. King was still in Montgomery. Dr. King called me and said, Fred, I'm at Reverend Abernathy's church, and I got a call from a boy in Troy. And he told me his name. He said, his name is John Lewis. He want to come up here and talk with us about integrating Troy State, the community college down where he lived. And he said, I sent him a bus ticket, a Greyhound bus ticket, to come from Troy to Montgomery. I want you to meet him at the bus station. Bring him to the church where we're having this meeting. And if he wants to go to Troy State, we want to see if you won't file a lawsuit for that purpose. I met him. He went. We talked. We found out, of course, we knew he was a minor. And he wanted to go to the law school. He wanted to go to the school down there. And Dr. King said, well, we'll help you go. And I said, well, that's one thing. He's a minor, so we got to get his parents. So John, go back, talk to your parents, and so we'll see what we could do. John went back, discussed it with his parents. His parents were farmers down in Pike County, and they said, well, son, we want to help you, but we got to live with these white people, and we won't file I agree for you to file the lawsuit against them. But they encouraged him to go on to school, and he went up to Nashville and went to Fisk and went to the American Seminary and got involved in the civil rights movement and became one of the greatest icons in the movement and ultimately died. He had his chief of staff, Mr. Collins, to call me on July the 8th, 2020. He knew then that he didn't have much time, but he wanted to talk to me. We talked, we had a prayer, and then we concluded, and I asked the congressman, I said, considering your great career as a civil rights leader, what do you want me to do? He said, brother, keep pushing, keep going, set the record straight. So I say to you here today who are working and who are celebrating this holiday for Dr. King, and I said to all who are listening and all people who are interested in civil rights, keep pushing, keep going, set the record straight. Do it in a nonviolent manner and continue to do it until justice rolls down like water and righteousness like a mighty stream. Thank you and good evening.
Thank you.
I hope I did it.
Yeah, you did it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
FC, all honor to his name, Mr. Gray, Mr. Fred Gray. All honor to his being for being here and being a force for what is right. I have done my job. I'm wrapped up. I hope I served you all well, and I hope I served the housing commission. I'm going to my housing brain. The holiday commission the best I could. So thank you. I'll turn it over to Elaine.
Thank you. And what I get to do every year, for those of you who are not running out of here, is to introduce to you the 2022-23 MLK Commission. These group of people, as I have said, don't just plan this luncheon, but they roll up their sleeves and lean into the work of doing civil rights. And so without further ado, I am going to ask my vice chair, who is the best vice chair of any vice chair anywhere, Kristen Wright-Meyer, to come Tony Baltimore, our first vice chair, Steve Japinger, our treasurer, Kelly Ellsworth Etchison, our secretary, Kwafo Adakra, Commissioner Brian Beverly, Commissioner Fonda Williams, Commissioner Bob Hoffman, Commissioner Michael Flowers, Dr. Lee June, Dr. Lonnie Lee, Dr. Denise Maybank, Ms. Rosa Hargrove, Nicole Noel Williams, Geraldine Potter, Kristen Shelley, and Anthony Winston. We're going to ask Pastor Chip to come and do a benediction, and then that'll be followed by our traditional We Shall Overcome, and Mr. Whitley Phipps will lead us. So if you don't want to miss his amazing voice again, I would suggest you stay. And I would really love to have Mayor Schor come and join us as well. Thank you so much. It has been our absolute pleasure to be back in person. We will see you next year, bigger and better. And I just want to leave you with two things, that we sometimes forget when we are in a moment to be in that space. I believe the mayor referred to it as being where your feet are. We happen to witness somebody chronicle a civil rights movement for us, a part of that history, that history, that living history, is right here with us. And I don't want us to lose the moment of that, right? He was standing here before us speaking, but he's the reason why we can be here. And sometimes when we come to events like this, we don't want people to say all the parts. Well, all the parts is that we got work to do, but we're not weary in well-doing. We're going to keep leaning our shoulder in, and as hard as people can hate, we can love them more. And as hard as people can tell us that the door is closed, we can knock harder, we can go through the window, we can tear the roof off the place. What I'm saying to you is that when we happen to be in this moment today, we're here together, part of watching history, experiencing living history, but we are the history, and people are waiting on us to do things. And so I'm gonna leave you with a charge that a year from now, when we get back together on the third Monday in January, I want you to take stock of where you have put your work, where you have put your money, where you have put your values, where you have spent your time, because we need you. Thank you so very much, and I'll see you next year. Pastor?
If you enjoyed yourself on today, say amen. Amen. Let's pray. Eternal God, our Father, we come on this day thanking you for this occasion. We thank you that you allow us to come here with a spirit of unity, understanding that injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We come to honor Dr. Martin Luther King as we celebrate his life, his legacy, his leadership. Dr. King has set an example for all us to follow. We thank you for this servant. We thank you for this soldier who walked by faith. We are grateful for the insight, wisdom, and understanding that Mr. Gray has shown us and shared with us on this day. Father God, we didn't realize it, but today we receive history in a mighty way. Father God, we ask that you be with this commission. Bless the leadership of this commission for all that they do, that allow us to keep focus on the task at hand. And then, Master, we thank you for the patriots and the matriots that went before us, who allow an individual like Rosa Parks to sit, and then Barack Obama to run for president of the United States, to remind us that the work is not done. So when we leave this place, Father God, allow us to leave this place with zeal to do the work you have called us to do. We just thank you for this day and all that have participated in it. This is your servant's prayer in Jesus' name, and all the people of God say amen.
Deep in my heart, I do believe someday we'll all be free. We will be free. I may not know how long 'twill be. Someday we'll all be free. We will be free. Someday we'll all be free. Hold on, my brother, give me your hand. Someday we'll all be free. We will be free. Learning to love, we'll find our way. Someday we'll all be free. We will be free. Someday we'll all be free. And we shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall shall